Okay, good afternoon. Today you watched the video on Augmented Lagrangian of penalty multipliers. I will remind you topic, and then if there are any questions, you will tell me. Okay, I just very briefly remind. So the idea of approach was shown on the example. Very simple problem, minimize function of one variable, subject to the variable x should be non-positive. And in penalty function method, we penalize it with penalty which becomes more and more sharp. And in penalty multiplier method, we introduced one more parameter, except of penalty parameter, we introduced parameter mu, which controls controls slope in the origin. And just wait for a moment, and if it's for common interest, we will discuss it together. And the very brief idea, we first minimize our penalty aggregate, which is objective plus our penalty multiplier function, and get to some intermediate minimizer, and then we see the slope of penalty function at this point, at the current minimum, and we want to copy this slope to the origin with the hope, for example, in this simple example, if the objective function was linear, we immediately, the next minimizer will be in the origin, and if objective function is non-linear or we have many constraints and many variables, we will become more close to the origin, and this is the idea of the method. So the new value of multiplier is just derivative of penalty multiplier function at the current minimizer. Yes. Yeah. Who was first? Yes.
When we change the slope, this stays the same. Right? After we change the slope.
After we change the slope, what is your question?
Penalty
parameter. It may stay the same, but actually, theoretical analysis shows when penalty parameter is larger. And for example, the function is not linear of objective function, all process come to the solution faster. But we pay for this because when the penalty is sharper, it's more difficult to do unconstrained minimization. So people try to find reasonable compromise. And this we will see on the next slide. Yes, and your question?
Why is this method better than the regular penalty function?
So the advantage of this, I should say you in the beginning, if you don't want to be too sophisticated, you might prefer penalty function method. If you want to get to very accurate solution, and we also see in the second part of the class, there is a very popular ADMM alternating direction method of multiplier, which work really, really well for very large problems. But quite often penalty function, disadvantage of penalty function method that when P becomes large, it may require too significant effort to do unconstrained minimization.
Yes,
with
why
Newton.
Using this method will get us to converge for smaller numbers of people.
Why do we converge?
Faster.
There is a convergence. There is a convergence analysis, which I referred to you, but canceled it because it requires some knowledge of duality, which we will get in the next lecture. There is a kind of theory, at least showing the fast local convergence, and also a kind of theory that shows. Then the changes in the function, when you are close to solution, those updates become very small. And if you do Newton for unconstrained minimization, in one Newton step, you may accomplish your next unconstrained minimization. Yes?
אתה יכול להסביר למה אם לא קום תהי גדול, זה מקשה לנו, אני לא מבין איפה זה מקשה לנו על האופטימיזציה, כי אתה נשאר עם פונקציה קונבקסית. אפילו אם אתה לוקח משהו מאוד חד כזה,
The question was when I take a very large P, if I take very large P, why unconstrained optimization is more difficult? Roughly speaking, to minimize this kind of function, it's not easy, for example, with Newton method, especially if you are start far from this corner, because what we do in Newton method? We use a quadratic model of our function. And quadratic model become very far from the true function when P is large and when you are far from solution. When you are close to unconstrained minimum, actually become better. Because like we told, when you zoom with my microscope on any function which is smooth, it almost quadratic.
Yeah, but if the P is extremely high, when you try to calculate numerically the gradient at the slope point, you will get a numerical error.
Yes. Okay. One more consideration, but it's one of considerations. And your second order model become more crucial. Okay. Let's go further. And here is a summary of the method for multi-dimensional problem. When we have many constraints and X is a vector variable. So we build our here is the problem. Minimize objective function with inequality constraints. We build penalty multiplier aggregate. And we first minimize it in X. And then update multipliers by the same scalar formula. For every constraint, we have its own derivative of penalty. And this will give us a new multiplier. And there is a complete series that shows that the sequence of these multipliers, they really converge to Lagrange multipliers of the original problem.
Yeah, but why is it faster?
Why it is faster? Because you can think that unconstrained optimization is easier than in penalty. Mm-hmm. I don't claim that number of external iterations will be smaller. But the cost you pay in the internal, in the unconstrained optimization here, may be smaller.
So it's like taking a step between penalty functions and the Lagrangian and trying to like get as close as you can to both methods?
You can think in this way. Okay. And the video you skipped, after next lecture you will be ready to see it. Maybe you will get more insight. Yes?
And then you with the Lagrangian.
Tell it again. You can tell in Hebrew and
Lagrange.
Okay. Did I have it in the lecture?
Yes.
I have it in the second lecture that you saw. You watched two videos at home. And in the second, there is even in penalty method we learned already, even without multipliers. If I do my penalty parameter stronger and stronger and do unconstrained minimization, we already learned in previous lesson the derivatives of those penalty functions become more and more close to actual Lagrange multipliers. And pay attention what we do here. We update mu to be derivative what you learned in previous lectures, that they are good estimates. You can better and better estimate of Lagrange multiplies. So this is your second motivation. Okay. One more very important case, because it's very popular, actually, historically, all notion of augmented Lagrangian started with this problem, and it had slightly different even motivation in the beginning. So, if we have equality constraints, so we say that if just penalty function is usual parabola, penalized because it penalizes by ratio to the positive and to the negative. But we want to have a function which has a slope at the origin. So if we add linear term, quadratic term has zero slope at the origin. So if we add linear term, this is exactly what we need. So this is our penalty multiplier function. And if you look on this problem, and say, substitute what we have here, we get very interesting expression. Very interesting expression. Those two parts correspond to two parts in penalty function. So the first part in penalty function, together with objective function, is usual Lagrangian. Objective function plus some multipliers multiplied by constraint. And here, a kind of added to Lagrangian, another penalty term for violation of constraints. And the name of the method Lagrangian came from here. But I gave you more general picture in the beginning, and this is my particular case. But this case is very important, because it gets also nice formula for multiplier update. You see your new multipliers is just old plus penalty parameter multiplied by violation of constraint, by value of constraint at your point. Okay, and I think this is all. And now we will come to the very briefly to the topic which is not covered in the video, but it's very important and very modern ADMM. I will show you the slide now. Alternating direction method of multipliers. And even there is somebody very famous in optimization, Stephen Boyd from Stanford, and you might know that he has great video course on convex optimization. It's more sophisticated than our course, but if you are mathematically advanced and like to have more general and more challenging presentation of the framework, not of the methods. In our course we cover more the numerical methods in there. So it's good to look on Stephen Boyd course. And here is a presentation from his review. But before our lesson, I prepared my own presentation, a couple of slides, which is actually more in our terminology. It will be easier. Let me okay. So ADMM. Let's do Control L. this is very close to what we learned now, only a little generalization. So ADMM is our alternating direction method, and it considers the case when our variable has two parts, x and z, and the objective function is separable, a kind of separable. It's function of x plus another function of z. And we have a constraint, it should be linear. It's some matrix multiplied by x plus matrix multiplied by z plus some constant vector. But I write it in our usual way. Some constraint h of xz should be zero. Just a second, I show you the next slide. Yes. And let me continue for one more formula. And then we build augmented Lagrangian like we are used to do. It our objective function plus sum of phi. Here only multiplies not mu but y. It's you may recognize here what we already did for equality constraint. Let me finish briefly this part and we will discuss now. I only never know how to remove this extra part. It's something. Some bug in this version.
Push space maybe?
Let me get back. Let me get back and we will see the whole picture.
Same windows, two different tabs.
Window, new window.
Yeah.
Now it's better.
But what's the y dependency in our equation?
Just a second. I want to put them together, maybe do it a little bit narrow. Let you see them together. Okay, now it's good. I'm happy. So we already had this, yes? Normal augmented Lagrangian. We have this penalty function, and this is our aggregate. This is actually the same. We only here we have one variable, and here we split them in the same variable in two parts. Okay, now the questions, and I am ready to discuss. Yes.
במקרה הזה, אני מניח שניתן נגיד מהמשוואה השנייה, וברוב המקרים, לא, כאילו הבעיה, אני לא מבין למה זה בעיה מיוחדת, כי אם נגיד עכשיו אני יכול לאלץ את Z ולבטא את Z במונחים של X, אז אני פשוט חוזר ל...
So the question is if in this function, for example, I can explicitly express z via x and substitute. Okay, then you are happy, but it's not interesting because in many practical situations you are not able to do it. you just have long vector of variables which has two parts, x and z, and we are lucky that in objective function it is separable. But in constraint it's not separable, it's mixed. It may be mixed. It may be separable or may be mixed, we don't care.
I can create a new vector, which is called x tag,
yes.
Which is at the first part it's x and the
yes.
second part of it is z, and then the same I do with h, and I
yes.
get one vector optimization and it's regular.
Yes, yes, yes. You're right. We can just reduce this to this and solve it like we already know. Interestingly, in many practical problems, if you build aggregate and ask what is minimum with respect to x, if you want to minimize with respect to x under fixed z, it may be much simpler problem, much easier problem. And if you want to minimize with respect to z, given fixed x, it's also a simple problem.
So I can take problem that is shown that way with one vector and split it into n vectors and use that, and it will be faster.
Yes, but let's advance one step more and then discuss again. Okay? And discuss again. I just want to get the bridge down. No. I want to get to general slide. Here is a full description of the method. So a little bit different than so what we do in usual augmented Lagrangian, we just put jointly optimizing x and z. And ADMM says that I can prove that if you do the optimization separately, you still will converge to solution, and there are many interesting types of problems that we will touch one of them as example, that really optimization in X, only in X or only in Z is easier, and optimization together is much more difficult.
And that is true always?
It's not always, it's like there are very many practical problems when this is the case.
No, when I optimize to x or to z, it will always be equivalent to regular optimization.
It's not equivalent. I should point. If you have function of two variables, two vector variables,
mm-hmm.
forget about this third one, and want to minimize in two of them together. It's not enough to minimize in first, fix it, and minimize in second. You get more close to solution, but you don't get to the minimum in both of them. You may, if you want to repeat it iteratively, it will call log coordinate descent. It will not, those two steps will not give you to the minimum in x and z together. This is the point of ADMM. And still, the method will converge. You do this partial minimization and update multipliers by formula, by the same formula which you already have,
mm-hmm.
and do it again, and the method converges. This is like a miracle, and there is a mathematical proof that it is so. Yes.
יש לי בסוד גם Z ו-Y שהם לא גבוהים, משתנים מהקטן, לא בודק את Z ו-Y.
So the question is, how do I minimize in one variable? Let's go to example and we will see. I will show you a very important example, which is called basis pursuit or lasso sparse representations. It's the most used example. Let's stop at this point, go to example, and then discuss it there. Stop, it's finished.
To stop the video? You want to stop the video?
No, just continue. Okay, let's go to the example. Where is my example? I prepared the slides in the last moment. So So we need to discover. Here is the example. Here is the example. Let's do it on larger screen. Okay. This is very well-known example. Assume that I want to solve least square problem, AX as close as possible to B. In particular case, it may be AX equal B, or maybe also no. And I look for a so-called sparse solution. I hope that there is a solution where most of components of X will be zero or close to zero, and I can vanish them. And this is an extremely powerful technique, sparse representation. Who likes may go to the special course of Mickey Lab. Whole semester is on this topic. Very hot topic, and many problems in signal image processing statistics are solved. And how people achieve the sparsity of X, they put additional penalty, sum of absolute value of components of X. Some lambda multiplied by norm 1 of X. And this is not easy numerical problem, because it's not smooth, it's not clear from the beginning how would you solve it. You can substitute absolute value with some smooth function and even run LDFGS for large problems, but there are faster solutions. And one of them, one of very efficient, was given by ADMM. People do the trick, they say instead of this term, we will call this, substitute this with new variable z, but we will require that x equals z, or x minus z is zero. And for this problem, we can, despite that it's not smooth, but still we, you will see that we can solve intermediate problems and get to the solution. And as the first part, I would this may be our class exercise.
We
have enough time. As the first part, I would propose you to write augmented Lagrangian for this problem. Augmented Lagrangian, so you have so minimum in X and Z. I forgot, sorry. This is objective, this is constraint, and you write down this kind of expression. Yes? You may use this here, yes? We already have. First of all, I propose you to write down augmented Lagrangian. Maybe we will keep it in terms of this, of ADMM. Let me open one more window, new window, and get one slide back. Okay, here you see everything in front of your eyes. So here is a general framework, and here is our particular problem. Okay, please write down augmented Lagrangian and show us on the whiteboard. And then gradually we will advance on this point. So this is f of x. Yes? This is g of z. And this is our constraint. Just write down it explicitly. rather write down it explicitly, because then you will like to minimize it in X and in Z separately, and you will see that it's two very easy problems.
Can you just remind us what is the explicit expression of norm 1?
Norm 1 is sum of absolute values of coordinates. Like norm P is sum of degrees of P of absolute value of components and root P root. And P is 1, you don't have any root, so it's just sum of absolute values. Okay, this is very formal and very short. I hope that many of you already wrote it. But we want to have it on the whiteboard. Did you? Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead and write it for us just to have it in front of our eyes. You can remove all this stuff and even turn light on. Okay, let me see. So we have this objective. Let's use this is white, yes? It's like to be in the same notation.
And
that
is white as well?
Yes, and this is white as well.
Okay.
I will. Thank you. And this is raw. It's B. In the notation of Stephen Boyd's paper. Okay, and now I ask you, I assume that Z is given, and of course Y is given. Let's minimize in X. Let's see what, assume that you are clever and you can solve linear equations. So we want to write down optimality condition. We want to write down gradient with respect to x. Pay attention that this is a quadratic function with respect to x. And so you should write